Excuse me, I pointed at the section of the docking ring where they stood. That's about as far as I can jump. Oh, they settled back to give me room, though not much. When I landed a few feet away, their hands flew to their sunglasses and I heard the familiar click, click, click of tiny levers being depressed as the women lightened their lenses. And my parents wondered why I hated visiting the Stag Cities. "You have beautiful skin," said the one in green. She sounded adult, which meant she should have known better than to gawk at a person. "Thanks," I tried to scoot it past, but the one in yellow blocked my path. "It's real." She slipped back her headscarf to reveal elaborately braided blonde hair, not painted on. "It's real." Shut it out above us on the promenade.
Settlements. Representative Tupper suggested, you should be grateful the Commonwealth allows you to pay your taxes and crops. We'd rather pay in cash. I recognize my mother's firm voice and spotted her on the left of the days. Pa also joked that, always joked that Ma looked like an Amazon, but only because of her height. She was a scientist, not a fighter. As she rose to her feet, she said, we'd get three times as much for our crops at market than what the government says they're worth, and you know it. Next to her, Pa straddled a chair deep in thought, his usual reaction to any problem. He ran a hand through his hair, leaving it spiked up like the prickles on a blowfish. Doc Gunsey, however, who was a dozen years younger than Pa, wore an expression that more closely matched my feelings. With his long legs stretched out before him, at first glance, Doc looked relaxed, but his frown, his mouth disappeared into the dark stubble of his beard. Even more telling, Doc massaged one scarred palm and then the other, which he only did when he was really vexed. Crops are cash, barked Raj Niarni, as he jabbed his seaweed cigar at Representative Tupper. Either way, the wealth is bleeding us dry. Gemma shifted nervously beside me. I suppose Raj did look pretty savage with his dive skin split open, showing off chest hair thicker than a seal's. And what do we get for it? He snarled. A few lousy supplies sold wholesale. A wet 80 ranger and a doctor who can't even make a fist. No offense, Doc. With a wry smile, Doc tipped his hat to Raj and the assembly. It wasn't true anyway. Doc could make a fist. He could, just couldn't perform surgery. And it wasn't like the station's infirmary was a hospital. We're not getting anything wholesale, Pa said, getting to his feet. Not lately. The Commonwealth hasn't sent us a supply of liquid gin in months. We're down to using the trade station's emergency stock. He waved at the dispenser in the corner with his empty glass tank. I surely hope the lower station doesn't sink during your visit, Representative Tupper. As do I, Tupper replied smoothly. Clammy fingers touched my hand. That's a joke, right? Gemma whispered. The station can't really sink. Her face was whiter than a pearl and almost as shiny. At that moment, the room lurched, which meant the down on the access deck is some big sob had just dimmed the rim of the moon pool while surfacing. Happened all the time. Gemma, however, didn't seem to know this. Are you going to throw up? I asked her. Lips held the bearer's smirk. The rain
it made me want to throw a chair at him. Since you all know the lay of the land down here, you'll flush out the Sea Plague King in no time. And once you bring them in, dead or alive, the Commonwealth will reconsider the benefits of helping Benthic territory to flourish. If the settlement survives that long, I said bitterly. Pa ushered me into the hall like I was a little kid. Gemma stood a ways down the corridor, watching a huge leatherback turtle swim past, but Pa didn't notice her. "Ty, this is important," he whispered, shutting the door behind us. So I heard. Reconsider the benefits. That wasn't even a guarantee. The wealth can't just change the rules in order to hunt down outlaws. Pa gestured for me to keep my voice down. "That's nothing you have to worry about." "Yeah, it is. If the territory goes under before I turn 18. "Listen, I have to get back in there." He sounded hoarse, and it looked as if new lines had been etched around his mouth. "Why are you here? Did something happen?" I hesitated. If I reported that the outlaws had likely murdered a prospector, how much more pressure would Representative Tupper put on the settlers to catch them? "Nothing," I said. "Forget it. I'd tell my parents and the other settlers later after Tupper had launched for the mainland." Hand on the door.